working in an industrial area, a large two-ton weight come down, striking him.
Nasty head injury. He's bleeding in his abdomen, he's bleeding from his pelvis, and he looks shocked and awful.
We're seeing an injury that is pretty bad.
Would you rescue me? What about myself? When I need your love, if I need your help, would you rescue me? Would you rescue me? But I start to wonder if I've slipping under, oh. Would you rescue me? Would you get my back?
We gotta staple your head back together.
There is a possibility he might die.
The Royal Melbourne Emergency Department sees hundreds of patients a day.
Daniel, can you page an EDA?
1, 2, 3.
Highly trained doctors and nurses are constantly dealing with life and death traumas.
That's what we like doing. We like fixing emergencies.
What the doctors don't like doing is working out new sticky labels.
How about put it on like that, put it in the bag, give them the other packet as well in the bag, and then they can do what they like. That's a lot of degrees between us to work that out.
Yeah, very important.
What is the heavy weight and where has it landed?
A call from Air Ambulance tells Senior Emergency Doctor Jonathan Papson he's about to get a patient who's been badly injured in an industrial accident.
Whenever the ambulance lead with industrial accident, there'll be something bad.
The young man on board is a crane operator who's been crushed by falling steel weighing over 2 tonnes.
Apparently 2 tonnes is like 1,000 kilos.
2,000 kilos.
How is he not dead?
How far away is this young fellow?
Should be here soon.
Good. The call is his blood pressure is actually quite low. Things are getting worse. So we might be in a lot of trouble by the time he arrives.
During the flight, the young man's blood pressure has dipped to 70.
When your blood pressure is low, that's a sign that you've got bleeding. We're worried about internal bleeding.
Callan was struck by a giant steel structure used to prepare bridge pylons.
Strap to your right leg, mate.
The massive industrial weight is believed to have come partially undone. It hit him with incredible force, equivalent to the weight of a ute.
Here we go. Let's get him in, get across.
Everyone ready? On three. 1, 2, 3.
Callan has just turned 21.
Okay, capturing an ECG.
Nurse Ebony Cameron is part of a large team of specialist doctors and nurses treating Callan.
This is literally the biggest team that you will see in the emergency department, the biggest scene that you will see, because we have everybody on hand ready for him.
He just had the blood pressure of 70 and he looks shocked and awful.
When we're talking shock, we're talking signs of blood loss. I think he's shocked. I'm going to give him some blood because that's what he needs.
Ebony, do you want to start running the blood?
Yes.
Yeah.
He's pale, he's clammy and his pulse is thready. And they are the other things you see in someone who's bleeding internally.
X-rays will show why Callan is losing blood.
He's been hit by a large, heavy object and pinned and then fell to the ground. So I think we've got a fracture.
Callan's dad has arrived at emergency and is waiting to see him. His mum is also on her way.
So he's got pubic rami. Yeah, OK.
So he's fractured the two struts in the pelvis that come around the front. It's terrible. It's a really serious injury. People with pelvic fractures, they have a mortality that just goes up every hour.
Over in Trauma Bay 2, a young woman is screaming and acting strangely. Paramedics brought her into the emergency department after staff at a shopping centre reported her erratic behaviour to 000. Senior emergency doctor Emma West hears the woman's screams and heads to the trauma room.
So as I'm walking in to see this young woman, I'm noticing that she's not making sense. She's moaning. She could be in pain. She's rolling around. She's behaving very unusually. And I'm really trying to figure out what's going on here.
Are we going to try and turn her at the same time?
Yeah. Yeah.
Is she pregnant?
It does appear like there could be a pregnancy there. She has denied that, though.
To me, she very much looks pregnant, and I'm surprised to hear that she said she's not.
I'm just wondering how she's gone from coherent to this.
I'm really worried about things like a drug overdose.
Just looking for... She's got no track marks.
Or a head injury, or, you know, perhaps she's been hit by a car.
Do you know where you are at the moment? How are you? Can you open your eyes for me? Emily looks pregnant, doesn't she? Oh. Yeah? I think so. There's something moving in there. No clonus, just thinking about whether or not it's like preeclampsia or something like that.
Dr. Emma is weighing up many scenarios, including the possibility the young woman is showing signs of a life-threatening pregnancy complication.
There are conditions like preeclampsia, which is a condition that occurs to women during pregnancy, and it can result in seizures and erratic behaviour. So they're the kinds of things that are running through my head.
I'm just having a look to see if she is pregnant. I think she is. I thought I felt a baby moving.
In spite of denying to paramedics she's pregnant, Dr. Emma uses ultrasound to examine the young woman. She can't treat her until she's absolutely sure what she's dealing with.
If a young mum has preeclampsia, they often have a dangerously high blood pressure.
Lift your head up for us.
So being able to diagnose it and get on to treating it immediately is a big priority. So I have to figure out if that's a possibility for this woman.
Is a baby in there?
Immediately I'm connected to what's inside, which is a baby, and it changes everything.
That's a fetal heart.
At Royal Melbourne Emergency, Dr. Emma West and nurses Jess and Yasna are trying to work out why a pregnant woman is semi-conscious after she was found acting erratically at a shopping centre.
My name's Emma. I need you to just talk to me for a short period.
Dr. Emma is considering a life-threatening pregnancy complication known as preeclampsia as a possible cause for the woman's behaviour.
To diagnose preeclampsia, the mum would have a very high blood pressure.
You're at Royal Melbourne Emergency and we're going to just do some tests because you're very sleepy. She's snoring.
Mm.
We got one blood pressure that was lowish normal, wasn't it?
103, yeah.
Although I'm considering preeclampsia, I get some information back that says that it's unlikely because she has a low to normal blood pressure.
So she's a young pregnant woman who could have a drug-related presentation.
Very frequently we see young people using GHB, which is a recreational drug, and I'm starting to realise that this is the pattern of GHB, erratic behaviour, sudden unconsciousness, and so now I'm really worried that that's the cause for this young woman.
I'm going to pop an ultrasound probe on.
Yep, sounds good.
A fetal monitor is placed around the woman's stomach to measure the baby's heartbeat.
Any recreational drugs can be totally harmful to a baby because if you're not breathing properly, your baby doesn't get oxygen. It can harm the baby in development. The baby could die. It's bad. It's really bad. You get it?
Yeah. I'd probably try and pull harder. Yeah, that's better.
Dr. Emma is a mother of four, and her heart goes out to the young woman who appears all alone.
When I reflect back on being pregnant, and I've been pregnant a lot, you know, it's a time of joy and it's a time of being supported by the people around me, friends, family. She's all alone and she's got no one with her. And so we're all she's got right now. And that's what emergency medicine is. When there's no one else there, we're always there 24/7.
Just be careful, there's no, like, sharps or anything in there.
Still not sure what the young woman may have taken, Jess looks inside her handbag for clues.
That could be the answer to the problems.
Emma?
What's that? That's GHB.
We're assuming it's GHB, yep.
OK.
At least that kind of answers our question.
I think so. You know, it's sort of a bit of a heart sink patient, really, because, you know, obviously she's pregnant, she's alone, she's drug affected, so, you know, this is pretty miserable. And the risks to her are not being able to breathe, and those risks are really doubled, tripled for her unborn baby.
Over in Trauma Bay 1, doctors are treating Callan, who was crushed by a steel structure used to make concrete bridge pylons. The weight was equivalent to being hit by a ute.
You've got a broken pelvis, all right? You've got a bit of bleeding inside.
Callan is pale, a sign of internal bleeding. But because he's young, his body is fighting back.
He looks awful. He's just got young person protection factor.
He has the ability, because he's a young person, to compensate despite the blood loss. So if you bleed, your body does a number of compensatory mechanisms to keep you alive. And his body's doing that.
The first bag of blood through.
Another bag of reds, please.
Nurse Ebony and the team pump more blood into Callan. They have to stabilise his fluctuating blood pressure before it's safe to move him.
Seems stable-ish, but, like, very high risk of deterioration.
Do you want to get an EDA? Because we can probably start going 10 minutes.
Dr. Jonathan wants to get Callan to the CT scanner. He believes the X-rays aren't conclusive and he's worried the 21-year-old's life is in danger.
The sooner we can get in there, find out what the bleeding is and stop it, the better.
What's your pain score out of 10 right now, buddy?
10.
10? Where is it mainly?
In my pelvis, my
hip. Okay. He was able to talk to me, he was awake.
Really give me a
headache. I know, buddy. We'll get it sorted soon. He was such a legend. He kept very calm considering the situation.
You know, my parents, my dad's here.
What does your dad do for work?
He works in Melbourne with Forest Victoria.
Apparently, he was out the front waiting for you.
Okay.
He was out the front well before you were here.
Okay.
Come on in, Paul.
Callan's dad, Paul, a commander with Fire Rescue Victoria, got the call about his son's accident while he was at work.
If you're the patient, you're all alone, you've got strangers looking after you, if you've got a relative with you, it makes things just a whole lot easier.
Got your dad here, Callan.
Hey, man.
Sorry, just grumpy day.
Aw, sweetheart.
What the hell is he? You're a champion.
He is grump anyone's day.
I'm not going to say live for these sort of days, but we live to watch our kids grow up, and you're going to do that.
Yeah.
You are most certainly going to do that. You are going to give leadership in the next 40 years. That's your job, right?
Yeah.
When it's your boy on the table, it's really pretty confronting, and he looked very broken.
She's on her way to come and see you as soon as she gets here.
Okay.
All right. So do you want to step out, Paul, because we're going upstairs to CT?
My heart sank pretty quickly. And then I sort of sat in the corner quietly and was grateful that we had that few moments, no matter what happened next.
All right, let's go. We're going upstairs to CT.
Before Callan goes into the CT scanner, Dr. Jonathan checks for any other serious injuries.
Just remember, we're going to be real gentle, right?
We always need to have a look at someone's back to make sure there's not an injury that we can't see, because we've had him flat on the back the whole time. But I'm principally looking to see whether he's got signs of a spinal fracture, and I'll be able to feel that.
Is that all there?
Yeah.
He's got a big abrasion, sort of TL junction.
If I don't look, I could miss something. If I do look, I could make the pelvis that was stable unstable.
OK, back when you're ready. That'll be the roll.
Callan's blood pressure begins to crash.
Can you check the blood?
We rolled him and the blood pressure's dropped. That was always a risk, but we were ready for it. The tricky part is we're now a long way away from the emergency department. The CT scanner is not an ideal place for a trauma person.
Feel like that?
If I need to do some resuscitation, I don't necessarily have all the things I normally have.
In Royal Melbourne Emergency, a young industrial designer is being brought in by paramedics after putting a drill bit through his hand.
Not sure what he was meant to be drilling, but I'm sure it wasn't supposed to end up in his hand. So we'll go see what's happening.
Emergency doctor Michelle Thornhill has to work out how to remove it.
Hello, is it Kyle?
Yeah.
My name is Michelle, I'm one of the emergency doctors. I'm doing well. What have you done to yourself today?
I was trying to drill a hole in this piece of plastic and then it caught and it must have just shot through.
Right.
32-year-old Kyle was helping his friend fix a scooter when the drill slipped, impaling his hand.
Putting in reverse did cross my mind, but I know what happens when you reverse drill. I didn't want to spin it in the wound if I could avoid it.
In these situations, there's usually the fight or flight response. It would have been a disaster if they had tried to pull the drill bit out of his hand. We have seen people come in with the whole machine attached because it was, you know, impossible to get it off. Any funny feelings, pins and needles
in
there?
Yeah, this one's a bit pins and needly. Oh, actually, on this side, that's quite pins and needly.
Right. You might have done something to the nerve there. So the hand is really complex. There are lots of small bones, lots of very fine nerves and blood vessels. Anything that penetrates the hand is a high risk of damaging any one of those little structures. So, look, first step is to get an x-ray and we'll see if it's done any damage to the bone. If not, we might be able to get it out for your hair and ED. Because it's a drill bit, it's actually tongued and grooved like a screw. So if you imagine that going in a clockwise direction, let's say, it may have actually entangled some of the structures in it. And when you try to pull that out, you might be doing some more damage to those structures and you pull it out. I will see you again once you've had that x-ray.
All right.
All right? OK.
The industrial designer seems relaxed about the injury, but Dr. Michelle isn't sure if the drill bit can be removed without causing more damage.
So being a tradesman, an injury like this could be detrimental to your future career.
Glucose is normal, lactate's normal, all the numbers are relatively normal.
Back in Trauma Bay 2, senior doctor Emma West suspects her 7-month pregnant patient has taken the drug GHB, risking her and her baby's life.
GHB is sedating and it suppresses your brain, so you're not able to breathe on your own. You run the risk of vomit going into the lungs. You run the risk of having very low oxygen levels, which can put your life at risk, and occasionally it can cause death. darling, have you just had some G today? Is that what you've had? Well, why are you all sleepy? Just tell me, all I want to know is what's happened.
Nothing more, okay? Sorry.
There's no treatment to counteract GHB. Emma can only monitor the baby's heartbeat for signs of distress.
You just had some liquid in your pocket. I think that's GHB, isn't it?
No.
OK, we're just wondering why you're sleepy.
No, please.
Unfortunately, we see recreational drugs with women who are pregnant at what should be the most joyous time of their life, but they've got this other illness that they're battling, and that's addiction. Emma, we're speaking at Royal Melbourne Hospital. I'm one of the emergency physicians. How are you?
Emma calls on the Royal Women's Hospital to help care for the young woman.
She's actually getting monitoring to see that the baby has got a normal heartbeat, and I don't know as yet. So I wondered if someone could have a look at it over there, if that's OK. Heart rate monitoring is actually quite reassuring, which is just fantastic. It shows that the baby has a healthy heart rate, it's moving normally, and that's all quite reassuring. But it doesn't take away from the fact that there's certainly a risk when the baby is born, having withdrawal from the drug, and certainly it's going to be a really difficult start to that young baby's life. Hello, I'm Emma.
Hi.
Hey, you're looking much better now. Do you know what happened or no?
No, I fell over.
Okay, I think we'll just see how you go, all right? There's a service at the Royal Women's, an addiction service for pregnant women, which I think says a lot. You know, that service exists is fantastic, but it also represents that there's a problem with addiction in pregnant women. And so that addiction service will be involved in the well-being of both this young woman, but also, importantly, the well-being of her baby. We're going to get the obstetric team to come and see you, OK? We're just going to move you to a different room. I just think that drug and alcohol addiction and social problems are rife, and that I can't put myself in her shoes, but it must be bloody awful. And then at the same time, I just feel for her unborn baby.
We're going to have to move trauma one out and put this one. She's just on the phone to her mum.
The emergency department is familiar grounds for nurse Sarah Thomas, who's worked at the Royal Melbourne for 6 years.
You just thought you'd come down, hang with us for the weekend.
Oh, God, you're so cute.
I love the adrenaline, I love the team environment, and I love being able to provide comfort and really highly skilled care to people that are having the worst day of their lives.
Sarah's been called to Resus Bay 4, where a patient is experiencing dangerously fast heart rhythms.
What's happened today?
It starts to notice my heart racing.
44-year-old lawyer Ben started having a sudden onset of palpitations at home.
I feel dizzy, lightheaded.
Yeah.
Ben was working away quietly at his desk when his heart started beating rapidly. Sarah can see Ben's heart is still racing, even after bed rest in the ED.
I'm surprised you're not feeling more short of breath with that heart rate. It's going up to, like, 170. His heart rate is beating between 140 and 170 beats per minute. It should be between 60 and 100, so it's beating extremely fast.
I can, yeah.
Emergency doctor Scott Taylor will assess Ben's heart and work out the best way to treat him.
G'day there. Hey, Ben?
Yes.
Hey, mate, I'm Scott, one of the doctors. How are you going?
Scott, thanks.
All right, so palpitations, a bit dizzy, lightheaded.
Correct.
What's happening at the moment is the top half of your heart is fluttering.
Yeah.
So rather than beating like this, it's kind of beating like this.
Yep.
And Ben has something called atrial fibrillation, or AF, as we call it, which is where the top half of the heart is beating really fast and in an uncoordinated fashion, and it makes the bottom half of the heart pump faster, and that can cause heart failure, heart attacks, or collapse. We have a very good way and a very effective way to put you back into a normal rhythm.
Yep.
We've got the option of performing what's called a cardioversion, where we basically use electricity to shock his heart. So My recommendation, very, very strongly, given that we've got a very clear indication, would be to give your heart some electricity.
Yep.
This is a very safe procedure, and once we explain that this is something that's medically necessary, it does make a lot more sense, and people are a lot more comfortable with that idea. Cool. All right, won't be long.
Cheers.
Ben's wife, Rhiannon, is a nurse, and while she's used to caring for patients, it's different when it's a loved one.
Seeing someone you love go through any of this is just so much more emotional. Just hard to think about, you know, the next stages.
The couple's two young sons, 10 and 7, are staying with friends. They keep texting dad jokes to try and make Ben feel better as he waits to be shocked.
My wife thinks we should allow our pets to share our bed. I finally gave in. After 10 minutes, our goldfish finally settled down. Okay, that's it. That's all I got. That's the good ones.
Pop some extra oxygen on for you. You want to just tip your head forward for me? That's it.
Right, we might actually get you to pop out to the waiting room. Is that okay? And then I'll come and get you in about 10, 15 minutes. It won't take long for us to do this. Yeah.
Rhiannon will wait outside, because the procedure can be difficult to watch.
Sit forward for me.
Sarah places defibrillation pads on Ben. The pads will deliver the shock.
All right, do you have any questions before we get underway?
Ben is anaesthetised for the electric shock.
I'll see you when you wake up.
So that's 50 approps. You still with us there, mate? Still with us? All right.
It only takes seconds to deliver the shock, but it must be given at a precise moment. If not, Ben's life is in danger.
What we're trying to do here with a cardioversion is basically reset the heart back into a normal rhythm, and we deliver a shock at a certain time in the heart cycle. So when you're ready.
Charging.
Sarah prepares to trigger the electric shock to Ben's heart.
Oxygen away, please.
If we deliver it at the wrong point, it can cause people to go into lethal heart rhythms and have cardiac arrest.
We're charged to 150.
Yep.
Everybody clear?
Feel off?
He looks pretty awful and pale, though.
At Royal Melbourne Emergency, 21-year-old Callan was just about to go into the CT scanner when he took a turn for the worse.
He just lost it. So he dumped his blood pressure as we rolled in.
Callan's fluctuating blood pressure dropped dangerously low when he was rolled to check for spinal injuries.
All right, so we're going with more blood.
Usually you get a transient drop in the blood pressure when that happens, and you can give a bit more volume, a bit more blood.
Yeah, I'll squeeze this.
Now, senior emergency doctor Jonathan Papson is urgently pumping blood into the 21-year-old to stop him crashing.
Keep going with blood.
They have to get his blood pressure up before it's safe for him to go into the CT scanner.
He's still conscious, still got a pulse.
Callan's fickle blood pressure is a sign he's bleeding internally.
Yeah, he's still conscious, still got a pulse. Looks okay. Yeah, just want to make sure we've got some safety before we start this. That's getting there. So it's getting better, it's still crap. Let's just CT. We'll keep going with blood. And then that'll tell us what we need to do. Yeah, okay, let's get out of here. Let's get this done. This is quite serious. He's bleeding internally in his abdomen. He's bleeding from his pelvis. So we're just gonna crack on with the scan and keep our fingers crossed that things work out.
It's an awful big thing to have such a major trauma when you're young like that, especially at work. It's a scary thing. He's got multiple injuries, and I'm always anxious about pelvic injuries. if I'm seeing the pubic ramus fracture on the plain x-ray, chances are it's a whole lot worse on the CT scan.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
Callan makes it through the scanner, his blood pressure holding. Now with the CT results on the screen, the team will know how to treat him.
Pelvic anterior lip seems to be intact. There's a bit of bleeding from pelvic side.
So he's got fractures in his pelvis, and he also has a fracture at the back of the pelvis that we didn't see on the x-ray. So that's probably why he was unstable in the CT scans. But there's not enough bleeding from the vessels around that area that we can treat. We don't actually have an operation we can do. So we're just gonna have to watch him and give him more blood and hope that things settle down.
Callan returns to the trauma room so doctors can keep an eye on him until he's seen by other specialists. Callan's mum has just arrived to see her son.
Hey, Mum.
Hey, gorgeous.
It must be awful to be the parent because you're kind of helpless. Aren't you? You're helpless. So there's the sort of the psychological trauma of not knowing and imagining how bad it must be.
It's all too much for Callan's mum.
I'm okay, Mum.
Oh, no,
your mother's all right. She's just gathering herself.
Callan isn't headed for surgery, but he faces weeks of immobilisation to mend his fractured pelvis.
Yeah, he's lucky, really. We can treat his pain and we can rest him and things should heal up without us having to operate.
All right. You set the blood pressure cycle to 2 once that's done.
Down the corridor, 44-year-old dad of 2 Ben is seconds from getting his heart shocked because it's beating too fast, a condition called atrial fibrillation, or AF.
Charging.
It's hoped the charge of electricity will put Ben's heart back into a regular rhythm.
It is a relatively high dose of electricity because the actual dose that's delivered to the heart is much smaller because of the tissue between the pads and the heart. It sort of dissolves most of that electricity.
With Ben under a short-acting anaesthetic, emergency doctor Scott Taylor is ready to shock his heart, delivering 150 joules of electricity.
Just triple-check that you're synced.
Yep, so we're synced. We've got good. Our spikes up here. We're charged to 150.
Yep, all right.
The cardioversion machine is synced to Ben's heart, so the electricity is sent at exactly the right time.
So the bottom half of the heart is beating. It's right at that time that we want the shock delivered.
Oxygen.
Oxygen away, please.
If it goes any later, you're delivering a shock as the heart is essentially relaxing, and then the heart can go even more haywire.
Everybody clear? Yep. Shocking. Shock delivered.
Hope he stays that way. Stay, 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 stay.
We delivered the shock at 150 joules, which in most patients with AF should be enough to put them back into a normal rhythm.
Stay, stay, stay. Nope.
The electric shock doesn't work, and his heart continues in a dangerous pattern of irregular beats.
I was saying stay, stay. I really wanted him to stay in a normal rhythm so that he wouldn't need any further attempts at shocking his heart.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
I'm going to give him a little bit more sedation.
Yeah.
I was really hoping that that being the end of it and not subjecting Ben to either a hospital stay or further procedures.
The team prepares to trigger a more powerful shock to Ben's struggling heart.
All right, so when you're ready, do you want to wind him up?
Do you want it at 200?
Yep. Stay, stay, stay. Nope.
In Royal Melbourne Emergency, father of two, Ben, has been given an electric shock to get his heart into normal rhythm. But it's failed.
I'm going to give him a little bit more sedation.
Yeah. Very shallow breathing.
Emergency doctor Scott Taylor tops up Ben's sedation so he and nurse Sarah can shock Ben's heart again. If the shock doesn't work a second time, Ben will need major surgery.
All right, so when you're ready, do you want to wind him up?
Do you want it at 200?
Yep.
So we're at 200, our sync's on. Sync charging.
Oxygen.
Oxygen away, please. Everybody clear? Shocking.
Oxygen back on. Stay.
Maybe.
All right. Good.
The second shock resets the father of two's heart back into a normal rhythm.
Ben, do you have any pain, mate? Good. You happy if I bring Rhiannon back in?
Mm-hmm.
Good. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
The highest risk of him having a stroke is the first few weeks after having the cardioversion. So it's really important that we offset that risk by putting him on a blood thinner, which I would hope would only be temporary.
Yep, you had two shocks.
Yep.
Yep. So you don't need to worry about anything at the moment. You just worry about taking some deep breaths and waking up.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
After that, with some good cardiology follow-up, his long-term prognosis should hopefully be excellent.
Have a seat. The anaesthetic itself is very uncomplicated. Feeling okay?
Slightly sleepy, but otherwise all right.
Good. All right. Fingers crossed things stay where they are. All right, good job. No worries. I'll be back in shortly, okay?
What was a precautionary trip to emergency turned out to be the day doctors saved Ben's life.
Generally all right. Slightly spaced out, but I'm sure I'll get through in another 10 minutes or so. I'll milk it whilst I can.
It's a great relief to Dr. Scott. There's no complications he has to worry about.
You're always a little bit nervous having a lawyer as a patient as well. You want everything to go right and nothing to go wrong.
Down the corridor, 32-year-old Kyle has a drill bit poking through both sides of his hand. He was impaled, helping a mate fix his scooter.
I really want it out.
Yeah, I bet.
Another friend, Nick, was able to detach the drill.
That's such a relief. Just as soon as you got that drill off, it was off, like,
yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Felt so much better. He was pretty calm when he got help, so calm that the others didn't really think it was that critical.
Kyle's off to have his hand x-rayed so emergency doctor Michelle Thornhill can see what damage has been done.
From here, it looks like you just have to angle like the other way. So you're angled this way a little bit, maybe just angle the other way.
It's not the easiest of injuries to x-ray.
If you look at it, you try and look at it and move your hand so it looks like it's going straight up and down.
Yeah, so that.
A little bit more that way, that direction.
Yeah, so that's straight up and down.
Yeah, I like that.
All right. Hopefully, don't see any bone.
Fits clear of the bone, eh?
That's a good
beautiful.
It looks like all the bones seem to be intact. There's no fractures or chips off the bone. We can clearly see the drill bit sitting there.
Dr. Michelle is still worried the drill bit has severed a nerve. A life-changing accident for the industrial designer whose work depends on full use of his hands.
How are you going?
Pretty good.
So I've spoken to the plastic surgeons. They're going to come see you and then they'll decide if they're going to take you to theatre. Yep. To open it out, because it only takes one moment of you not paying attention to what you do or the slightest slip of the hand, and then he's not able to work for who knows how long. Could be weeks till he recovers, or if the injury is severe enough, it could stop him from working for the rest of his life.
Yeah, the hand's getting pretty sore.
In the Royal Melbourne Emergency Department, 32-year-old Kyle is waiting for doctors to remove a drill bit which went through his hand.
It's just aching more and more as time goes on.
Hi, I'm back.
Emergency doctor Michelle Thornhill gives Kyle a nerve block to relieve the pain before he goes to theatre.
He's being, I think, quite brave, quite strong. Even though he's sitting there watching this large drill bit in his hand, he's still maintaining his composure and taking all the treatments in his stride. Like I said, that should kick in a few minutes.
Probably going to be pretty tricky to take out, if not in theatre.
Plastic surgeon Dr. Rory Middleton explains the potential complications of the surgery.
With a wound like this, there's obviously, you know, risks of infection. Bleeding and you do have structures there that, you know, nerves, blood vessels and tendons which can be damaged.
Yep. So from here, he's going to have surgery with the plastic surgeons and they will remove the drill bit and then explore and see if he needs any repairs done.
At the time of the accident, Kyle was helping his mate repair his scooter. But this is not how good deeds are supposed to end.
It is fairly common that the friend you get to help you do the renos around the house is the person that gets injured. So I hope Kyle's friend doesn't feel too badly. These things happen all the time.
Dr. Emma's patient, a young woman 7 months pregnant, was suspected of taking the drug GHB, endangering her and her baby.
We're going to just do some tests because you're very sleepy.
She was kept overnight for observation and discharged the next day.
We're charged to 150.
Yep, all right.
Everybody clear? Yep, shocking. Shock delivered.
44-year-old dad of two, Ben, had his heart shocked twice to fix an irregular heart rhythm.
Stay, 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 stay. All right. Good.
He was discharged the next day with no complications. Surgeons successfully removed the drill bit from Kyle's hand.
I asked for the drill bit back because it had the piece of plastic I was working on, and I need that to finish fixing the bloke's scooter at work. So the surgeon was more than happy to put it in a box for me and give it back to me, so there it is.
What's your pain score out of 10 right now, buddy?
10.
10? Where is it mainly?
In my pelvis, my hip.
21-year-old crane operator Callan suffered 9 breaks to his pelvis and a broken leg after being crushed by falling steel at work.
He just had the blood pressure of 70 and he looks shocked and awful.
First thing I'm doing is going camping again.
Yeah, and the dog?
Yeah, he'll come.
9 weeks later, Callan is walking again.
I do remember being on the ground at work and crying because I'm thinking, I'm not going to make it out of here. There's stuff I haven't done yet that I want to do, but I'm not going to get the chance.
A little bit slow.
Callan spent 3 weeks on his back in hospital and a month in a wheelchair, drawing strength from the never-give-up approach of his mum, Amy.
My baby's broken, but you just got to do what you got to do. So, you just go into mum mode.
Alan's dad, Paul, a fire chief, has nothing but praise for the medical care his son received.
We're very blessed in Australia and particularly this state that an event like Callan's can occur and a little on 2 hours he's getting probably the best medical care that anyone can find anywhere. The ambulance service, the decision to take him straight to the helicopter, straight to Royal Melbourne, all of those things saved time and in essence gives us our boy back. Ready?
Yeah, can you bring that, please?
I can do that.
The long-term prognosis is I'll actually be fine. I'll be able to do everything normally, be able to get back onto my fire truck and all that sort of stuff.
Look, Bronte's going.
You're not supposed to screw your face up. Happy days, mate. Happy days.
Yeah.
Happy days.